Our next speaker is Peter Abraham, and he's going to talk about time variability and disk geometry in Herbig A star's simultaneous optical infrared study of the UX Orionis phenomena.
Let me call like the necessary equipment. Thank you very much. My name is Peter Abraham from Concordia Observatory, Budapest. My field of research is the formation of stars. And my special interest or my hobby within that, actually, I would like to understand the interaction, the connection between the young stars, the protostars, and their environment, so to say, the placenta from they are formed, and that is the circumstellar disks. And I had to realize during the years that variability is really a great way to study this connection. So why? If we know that young stars are variable in the optical, and if you just look at the classical classification of the optical variability, then these three main categories are usually mentioned, that we may have cool spots on the stars, hot accretion spots, or variable obscuration, and you have to realize that the second two are related to the circumstellar disks. Even more information can be extracted if you focus on the infrared part. Why? At the mid-infrared part, you actually see the circumstellar disk, it not only indirectly via its effect, but you see its thermal emission. Originally, it was just assumed that in the infrared circumstellar disks are constants. Of course, if you have just one single measurement, then you make this assumption that the flux is constant to publish something. But later, if more and more data were collected, now we are, it's absolutely clear that the disks and these young systems are strongly variable even in the mid-infrared. So these are just light curves at 4.5 micron. But what could cause the variability of a circumstellar disk? We may have different effects. Unfortunately, I cannot show you these nice videos, but just try to imagine that if the luminosity of the central star is changing for any reason, that it will irradiate, heat up, or cool down the interstellar matter around that. And if it's warmer, then it will emit more. So that causes a variability even in the thermal emission of the dust around. Also, it's possible that the central star is just constant, but if we had turbulence, you lift up from time to time accidentally some dust clouds above the disk, then you have more radiating surface. So again, the thermal emission of the disk would change in this case. One can imagine also a special geometry that there is a bright part of a disk, and if it's orbiting, then from time to time it becomes in a position that is not very well visible. In other cases, it's better visible. That would also give you some variability of the thermal emission. And finally, this is our topic of the conference. If you just imagine that there is some circumstellar matter which occludes the system, even the part of the inner disk, not only the star, then that's also a possibility to change the flux of a young star. In the last case, you have to keep in mind that the mid-infrared emission we are talking about, it comes not only from the star, but actually from the disk. And since this is dust we are observing, it cannot be closer to the star than the sublimation radius. As Vladimir just showed, that the typical sublimation radius for these systems is half an AU radius, more or less. If you want to occult the whole part where this emission comes, then you need an occulting body which is about 1 AU, half an AU radius. So I would put here this number just to remember, 1 AU, please keep in mind, that if you want to cover the inner part where the mid-infrared emission comes, that you need such a big body. This is another image how the dust emission is located. So, because we were interested in this connection in the infrared between the stars and the disk, we started already a program years ago. I won't report on the result much because it was published by Agnes Kospal, who is sitting here. But the main point was that we collected mid-infrared spectra between 2-3 micrometer and 12 micrometer, and from different instruments, from the Infrared Space Observatory and also from the Spitzer Space Telescope. And what we could see, that in those cases where we have more spectra, we saw strong silicate features, and they were always variable. There are different explanations for that, but it was a very interesting result. The project I would like to report today is a different one. That was a photometric monitoring of this sample of stars. Everybody knows these names now. It seems everybody works in the same subset of Yuxars. So what we did, we observed them for 14 days. It's a much smaller data set that Vladimir reported. It's just a 2 weeks program. We tried to observe them in optical wavelengths. It's mainly from Hungary, our observatory, this Schmidt telescope, also from the Canary Island. We also obtained GHK data from the Canary Island, and we used the Spitzer Space Telescope to try to get simultaneous observations with our optical and near-infrared data. That's the Spitzer. So this is just to show, because you like the light curves, I will show the light curves now for you. So this is a summary for BF ORI of the V-band observations of many years. So this is several decades. And red shows that our observations were performed when the source was relatively bright, it's in a high state. But we were really lucky, because in our just 2 weeks program, we could accidentally catch a nice first half of a whole fading part. So this is looks like an Uxor event, and we could sample half of it completely randomly, just measuring at the right time. These are the light curves. This is the BVRIGHK, and these are the two Spitzer wavelengths, 3.6 and 4.5 micrometer. In general, you see that, as we heard before, the amplitude is decreasing, so the light curves become flatter and flatter if you go for longer wavelengths. This is RR tau, where we could get the source, our red points, at a kind of intermediate brightness, and we were again lucky, I don't know how, but we could get the second part of a nice fading here. And the light curves are kind of self-similar, again the brightness amplitude changes. As we see here, well, here I would not say that we certainly caught a nice fading, but we found something interesting, which I will explain a little bit later, that actually the same anti-correlation that Vladimir reported before, that in the infrared wavelengths and the optical wavelengths, we go in the opposite direction. For UX-ORI, that was a surprise to me. If you look at the many years brightness distribution, you find that we probably sampled a star in a historical minimum. So I see only one or two points deeper than that, and it seems that there was a big depression here, a very faint part of the star, and we just observed the star in that stage. And that caused very strange light curves, because in the B and V, practically the light curve is flat, where at shorter wavelengths we have some structure. So that's why when my PhD student showed these light curves, I asked him to check the filters, because I saw that it must be the B or V band, and that must be somehow the I. So I accused him that maybe he just rotated the filter name, so the filter wavelengths. But he double-checked it and came back, no, he did it right. And then we realized that it is a really extremely faint location when the star was just accidentally caught. For V517 Cygni, we were again lucky. I don't know, it was a lucky program, because we could sample very nicely the second part of a nice Uxor-like event. For VVSER, again, it seems that we found something quick changing location. For VX Cassiopeiae, we could sample actually a fading event. And for VVVVVUL, we were more at the bottom of a depression. So in general, I was quite happy with this data, just really accidentally, we found at least five nice fading events. So what could we do with this data, at least some analysis? So my first question was that, okay, it's clear that if we take the different light curves at the different wavelengths, here I put three representative ones. This is the B, this is the I band, and this is the Spitzer wavelength. Then the amplitude should decrease. If you have a fading, so they just have a sheet in front of the whole system, then this is what you expect, that the amplitude of the light variation would decrease gradually, and the amplitudes decrease according to the interstellar extinction law. So actually you can predict how much should be smaller the amplitude of this than this one. This is just a ratio of the extinction curve from this wavelength and that wavelength. So we can try actually, of course it can be checked whether these variations are according to the extinction law. Now let me show another technique. I just saw that then what if I scale up this light curve, I just increase the amplitude accordingly to the light curve as if it was an I-band measurement. Then it should be similar or parallel to this one. And this is a B-band blue observation, but what if I scale down its amplitude according to the extinction law between B and I? And then it should be just completely parallel to the I-band. And if it's done, then we can say that a simple extinction event explained all what we see. So let's see. These are the original light curves, and these are our corrections. That this is the I band, I did not change, and the B band actually became really parallel to that. And I would argue that even at the infrared wavelengths, the slope of these data points is really parallel to this one, and also it flattens at the right place. So I concluded from this that really all the light curves for this event can be just explained by the simple single AV fading and nothing else. It's simple. There are two other cases, RR tau. But again, if I just take these three representative wavelengths, scale up the amplitude of the infrared and scale down the amplitude of the B band, then I get three parallel light curves. They are very similar, so that convinced me that here again we just see a very simple extinction events, nothing else. Also the same for VX-CAS, but these are the original light curve. And after scaling up and scaling down respectively, we get actually three parallel lights. So, but we can say that in a few cases, we are astronomers, so we're used to astrostatistics and can make statistics already from two cases. So here we have five fadings, and three out of these five could be just explained very simple with a simple extinction event. It means that if you recall this one AU, in this case, is somehow the extincting cloud must be the size of the order of one AU, since this is the area where our emission comes. So life is simple. If we don't look, for example, at BF Ori, where we have again the three representative wavelengths, and if I correct them to get my parallel curves, but I see that the I-band and the B-band curves are indeed kind of parallel. There is a little bit of bluing which makes it flatter. But the Spitzer light curve, that is much, much steeper. So what we see here, that the source faded simultaneously at all wavelengths, but in the infrared, it is faded much more than it should be if it's just a single event. And for Wewe-Wewe-Wool, it's also a bit similar. It's a different complication case. It did not change in the optical, in the B-band and I-band, but somewhere in the middle, actually the infrared started dropping without any signature in the other bands. This is the scaled-up version, so in reality we have to say here it's not a big thing, but clearly within our error bus it's a clear drop, so we don't see it. How could we explain it? For BF-Ori, we say that If it's just a simple extinction event at all bands, so we just cover the whole area with a homogeneous sheet, then it should be like this. But it arrived to here, so there is a delta mag, which we need to explain. What can we say? Probably this obscuring cloud is patchy on this 1 AU scale, so we have somehow denser or deeper extinction parts outside the central zone, and maybe there is a clearing toward the central part. For the other case, when it just suddenly in the infrared started dropping, but not in the other, I could imagine a scenario that a bright part like this, where we get the infrared emission, just turned into a less visible position. And that's why it will not affect the central star, but this part rotates and we don't see it anymore. I want to go back for the CVCFI just very briefly. As I mentioned here, what we found, that in the optical, in our short 1 week campaign, it was dropping, but in the infrared wavelengths, at the 4.5 micrometer, it was increasing. So for that, I just would like to mention that together with our chair, it was 11 years ago already, that we wrote a paper where we tried to explain, we saw the same effect, the anti-correlation between the V-band and the mid-infrared wavelengths based on some infrared space observatory data. And we explained it with a scenario that if you have a puffed-up rim, if it's higher, then it emits more infrared emission but occults the star. And if it's lower, then it produces less infrared emission because the surface is smaller but lets the star see better. So that would provide the anti-correlation for that. Finally, I would like to show that infrared astronomy, infrared data better, but they are great, but we also have some new data which are not infrared but optical, but I would like to call attention. The TESS, this NASA satellite, which is observing the whole sky now, typically 1 month per object, we got the first data. I mean, these are public data, anybody can download and study them. We checked which of this UX-oriented sample were already observed by TESS. We found 3 cases. And this is UX-ORI itself. This is the TESS light curve for 1 month, basically. What you see that it's extremely high quality data, and one can check a lot how the light variations occur, and it's a very smooth light curve. But would be nice to have some color information for that. So we also collected data from this ASAS survey. This is a ground-based all-sky survey. They try to get observations every night. And this is a kind of the TESS observed in the I-band, and the ASAS observed basically in the V-band. So you can get a color information from the two, which is a very nice. Probably if you would draw the extinction path, it would be absolutely parallel to that. So here, all the variation what we see here, this is just one physical process, probably changing extinction. For very wool, the other where we have already data, again, we see some fluctuations. Also, the light curve is not that smooth. There are these very small-scale ripples on that. I don't know what it is. Again, we collected ASAS data, and the color diagram says that it's something else. It doesn't show the extinction path. It shows basically a gray variation and just noise that we don't know yet. And this is BF40, the third one. Here we don't have ASAS data. It was too bright for this ASAS telescope, unfortunately saturated it. But again, in this 1 month, we could see really very well measured deep features. So I think we will obtain a lot of information studying these TESS light curves in the future. Thank you very much. Yes, I used it.
But it's not, maybe not quite correct, because we often see that nautical that she's going
Yes, yes, yes.
And could you show slide with interpretation for
this one, yes.
It seems that this would be suitable interpretation for Kitao Vista, where the operation radius is very small. And in a few days, you can rotate the inner ring and produce the effects with visibility of hot spots. But for this star, the operation radius is.
You are completely right. Actually, I saw that I should mention and call your attention to this very, very quick change. So it's really if you need large clouds to cover change in 1 day or 2 days, that's just critical. Well, I invented this explanation yesterday night, so we can figure it out and improve it still. But thank you, it was very good. The test light curve or our?
The red points you show, I think it's theta, right? What is this black curve and what is red?
Okay, these are just observations from the literature, but I could find, and this is something like 30 years. So each line is actually one year. This one? Yeah, here, this is the same kind of data from the literature, but I could find. Okay. Could find. So and these are the red ones, our data points.
Okay. Thank you.
Yes, at the back.
Going back to BF4E and WWW,
the interpretation page?
This one,
yes. Yes, yes, yes.
So I was wondering whether these curves correspond to cooling curves in the infrared, like material that's gone behind the screen and started cooling.
Yeah.
Yeah,
I was always thinking about some shadowing, especially after the talks yesterday, that maybe if we get a part of the disk shadowed, then it cools down very quickly because it's the surface of the disk, you can cool it down within minutes. So it could react very, very quickly. The only point that the emission comes from at 3-4 micron comes from the innermost part of the disk. So this material which produces the shadow should be still closer to the star, but there is just the hole there, so that I could not put together it, the geometry, that the material should shadow itself. Or
Do you have examples of
heating? No. Interestingly, only these cases. Again, this is some astrostatistics, of course, that 2 out of 5 fadings are difficult. That was my result. Yeah, about your paper.
The 12 micron, so the 12 micron variability, what you refer to, that it is the silicate feature.
Yes.
So that must be much further away in the star, so it doesn't fit to any screen model. Does it also show no correlation to the other variability?
That's an interesting question because these are not simultaneous observations. I tried to find actually observations at these dates. And in one case in BF4E, I could find some data, and it seems that there is some correlation between this and the optical changes, but typically we don't have the data for that. We don't have the simultaneous data. Yeah. Okay, let me add finally that this is really just observations. I reduced them, and this conference was a great occasion that look at the data, see if you have any idea about the interpretation, which kind of analysis I could do. Would be nice to have some quantitative analysis, then please just come to me. Thank you very much.